I am Kim Chappell. I'm secretary of the board and today's worship associate. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Lancaster on this first day of the Christian Advent. This past Friday was World AIDS Day, which begins a month of HIV/AIDS world awareness. Wednesday will be St. Nicholas Day. Hanukkah will begin Thursday night after sundown. And Friday is Bodhi Day, celebrated as the day that is said Buddha attained his enlightenment. Here at UUCL, we come together to worship, to nourish the spirit, to connect in love, and to act for justice. We welcome you this morning just as you are, whatever your heritage, whatever your faith, whomever you love, however you identify. Today, you are part of this spiritual community. And if this is your first time here, may you soon discover that it is also your spiritual community. As has become our custom, let us give a special welcome to all those joining the service this morning on Zoom. I invite those on Zoom to turn on your camera and share a wave together. And everyone in the sanctuary, let's wave at the camera at the back of the sanctuary to send our greetings. We welcome you to move and be you. As part of this welcome, we have what we call spirit play materials outside the sanctuary in the women's memorial room at the back of the sanctuary and at the end of the pews. Spirit play is meant to engage your heart, soul, and mind during the service, if you would like. In the women's memorial room, there is a table with activities for all ages. I would also like to welcome you this morning and invite everyone to take a moment to consider this sacred space that we are now in and acknowledge the truth of the land beneath and around us. We are gathered on land once inhabited by people known as the Susquehannock and the Conestoga. We acknowledge the violent legacies of genocide, displacement, and settlement that led to our being here today, and remind ourselves to live humbly in relation to this land and with all the indigenous people still living and loving on this continent. May we also acknowledge that the wealth and foundation of the United States was built upon the labor and toil of enslaved peoples. Many indigenous people will say, all are relatives. May we live into this truth and aspiration together. And now it is my pleasure to introduce our minister, the Reverend Patricia Guthmann.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. On this rainy day, it's a perfect day for a blue, blue Christmas, yes. And I think Advent, yes, begins today, so it's official. Christmas has started. Let's see, just a few more shopping days left for Christmas. The celebration and the holidays, but today isn't about stressing about it. Today isn't about being perfect and meeting all the holiday expectations you may have placed on yourself. Today is about being gentle with yourself and refreshing a bit and moving a little with jazz and not feeling too bad that maybe you're not ready for Christmas. Maybe you don't have to feel pressured to be happy when you see a Christmas tree, but let yourself be you. That's what Blue Christmas is all about. Many congregations have started to hold Blue Christmas or longest night services to recognize our hearts and our minds and our spirits don't always meet what we are told by Hallmark we should be feeling during Christmas, yes, and the holidays. Our Reverend Carl Gregg encouraged us to bring our full selves into each moment during the holidays. It includes messiness of our past and our present, all the joy and hope and peace, but also the pain, sorrow, and tragedy. In this spirit, I will read words from the Reverend Lindsay Bates as Kim lights our chalice. May this chalice help us to face the world's shadows and be a chalice of light, to face the world's coldness and be a chalice of warmth, to face the world's terrors and be a chalice of courage, to face the world's turmoil, and may this be a chalice of peace. May the glow of our chalice, the chalice of this community and circle of care, glow and fill in our spirits, our hearts, and our lives, and remind us of our ability that we can love and be loved beyond belief. May it be so. And so to start off this blue and jazzy Christmas, it only seems right that we should sing about a blue Christmas. And I encourage everybody to put on your best Elvis, if you'd like. And the lyrics are in the order of service.
Ready?
I'll have a blue Christmas. Without you, it's okay to say it. I'll be so blue thinking about you. Decorations of red on a green Christmas tree won't be the same. But I'll have a
to dress up as Elvis today, but well. This is the time in our service where if you're a child in spirit or in age, you're welcome to come on up and join me. There's many different songs we sing during the holidays, and we're going to talk about one that could be very old. Anyone want to join me? All right, Anthony. You're on it. All right, I'll tell you a story. Hey, sweeties. We got them in all sizes. All ages. Oh, look at those girls. Oh my goodness. You know, so some songs that we sing at holiday times are really fun. Some are really old, some are really new. We got rap Christmas and hip-hop Christmas and classical Christmas, all sorts of Christmas songs and holiday songs. And there's one that I'm thinking of because there's some songs. Today we're talking about a blue Christmas. And I don't know if you know that when we say we're blue, sometimes we're sad during the holiday time. Sometimes our expectations aren't met. Sometimes we don't get what we thought we'd get. There's reasons why we might have a blue Christmas. We might not get to see the people we want to see, or maybe we'll never see them again. So sometimes we're blue at Christmas. So some songs at Christmas time can be sad and kind of mysterious. And I'm going to have Eli sing a verse that from one of those songs that's kind of mysterious. So Eli, if you could sing that for us.
I wonder as I wander out under the sky how Jesus the Savior did come for to die for poor ornery people like you and like I. I wonder as I wander out under the sky.
Really beautiful. Thank you, Eli. Now, this is an interesting song because we only know about that first verse and the melody for sure. About close to 100 years ago, a guy who really loved music, his name was John Jacob Niles, was realizing, as many other people were realizing, that the songs of the Appalachian Mountains, and in the U.S., they stretch, that range stretches from Maine all the way into Alabama. And many of those people had lived there from before we were a country, when we were just colonies. There were people who had come from England and Ireland and Scotland, had settled in those mountains and had never moved on. And it was a very poor area. And in 1933, our country, a lot of people were struggling and were without homes, without food. And John Jacob Niles were in these Appalachian Mountains in Murphy, North Carolina, and he was trying to record these songs that we thought maybe we'll lose them of 100 years old. And he was in Murphy, North Carolina, and at that time, there was a preaching family who would camp in town to town. They lived in there, yeah? Oh, wow, you heard about the Loch Ness Monster, and it started in 1933 in Scotland,
that's
right?
When they spotted.
That's when they first spotted it, is what he says. We can Google that, yes? Wow. So that was a while back, and John Jacob Niles was in Murphy, North Carolina, and there was this family that had camped in the town square. They lived out of their car, and they would go town to town preaching and giving sermons and having really exciting meetings with a lot of music. And there in the town square, they slept and ate and hung their laundry out at the Confederate monument, is what was happening. Well, some people thought they were a nuisance, and they were about to be kicked out of town by the police. Yeah, yeah, and they were. And what they said is, we need enough money to have gas to get out of town. Can we have one more revival?
No way.
Well, the town said yes. And the town let them have another revival to raise money. And John Jacob Niles was there. And on the back of their automobile was a platform where they would store all their camping stuff when they would travel. But when they would camp and cleared it off, that was their stage, where the family would preach and the family would sing and perform. And at this last revival, it was the Morgan family. Annie Morgan stood at the edge of the platform. John Jacob Niles says she clearly hadn't washed for a long time. Her hair was in her face. It looked like yarn, all knotted and coiled. But she was beautiful, and her voice was beautiful. And she sang that first verse of a song that Eli just sung. And he kept trying to have her sing the rest of the song. He was trying to write it down, trying to get the melody. He wanted to know the verses. Well, every time she sang it for a quarter, she would just sing that first verse. And he'd give her another quarter, she'd just sing the verse, another quarter. Well, finally he gave up. And he wrote more verses to the song. And the special thing about that song is it could be like hundreds of years old, the words and the melody. But another thing about the song that we were just told by Eli, it's for poor, ordinary people like you and like me. And they were singing it in the Depression when there was a lot of poor people in need. And so it's a song that is supposed to give hope even to ordinary people like you and like me and the people of the Appalachian Mountains of the time. Because he just happened to hear Annie Morgan sing it. It was recorded for all of us to sing it forever. Who knows if we would have heard it again, right? So during this season, if you're sad, or you're disappointed, or you're feeling lonely, know that it's supposed to be a time for all of us, even for you and for me. So I think there might be a program, is Gwen here? There might be a program today for the children, or the playroom might be open, or you can go back to your seats, but Eli's gonna sing the song for us again and go through the verses. Two more verses that John Jacob Niles then wrote himself. I wonder as I wander. Anyway.
When Mary birthed Jesus, 'twas in a cow's stall, with wise men and farmers and shepherds and all. But high from God's heaven a starlight did fall, and the promise of ages it then did recall. If Jesus had wanted for any wee thing, a star in the sky or a bird on the wing, or all of God's angels in heaven for to sing, he surely could have it, 'cause he was the king.
Thank you. So let's go to that place, that quiet place in our center, and a place we can rest in prayer or meditation. Find our heart. Remember, we're breathing. That's all we got to do in any moment, is just keep breathing in and out. I'm going to share words from, actually, she was my supervising minister, my ministerial supervisor when I was an intern, the Reverend Maureen Caloran. She says, no one is ever really ready for Christmas. If we were really all prepared, and every gift we had contemplated had been obtained, and every present was beautifully beribboned, if all the goodies our friends deserved were baked and cooled and stored just so, if each and every person we love was gathered at our celebration, if we never snapped at anyone we cared about, nor stopped short of being all that we could be, if our minds were 100% loving and our hearts were 100% generous, we would not need this holiday quite so much. So come, Christmas. Come with the reminder that love does not depend on perfection, but on a willingness to risk connection. Come into the unready manger of our hearts, that we may feel the warmth of new life and give flesh to the promise of hope that cries to bring healing into our world. Come, Christmas. Come, love. Come, hope. Be born in our unready hearts in the silent and holy nights that lie ahead of us. May it be so. And this is a time when we hold the joys and sorrows and complex truths that we have here in our hearts and minds, in our own lives, in the whole world. What a time it is. I'm going to name a few, and then I will welcome you to come. And as I'm saying each joy or concern, Kim will lay a stone in the sand, and when I'm done naming these, you'll be welcome to come up and in silence lay your own stones. We keep placing stones of concern and care for all that continues to unfold in Israel and Gaza, West Bank. There was some respite during a brief pause in the major fighting. There was the release of hostages and the letting in of some humanitarian aid. Yeah, but still, there's heaviness of uncertainty about the future for this region. May the violence end soon, and may there be peace. Many stones. There are so many connections that citizens in the U.S. have with the residents of the West Bank, Gaza, and Israel. I'd like to place a stone of sadness and healing for the Reverend Marlene Walker and her family. Marlene serves as an interim minister in Racine, Wisconsin. I don't know if any of you know Kate Walker, who served in Meadville, Pennsylvania. Marlene is her stepmother. And also, Marlene serves right now on the UU Ministers Association Board of Trustees. Her family recently learned that her cousin Guy, an aspiring musician living in Israel, was being held hostage in Gaza, and he died in captivity. So a stone for Marlene and her family. A stone of sadness and care for the three college students of Palestinian descent who were shot over the Thanksgiving break in of all places, Burlington, Vermont. Right away, I paid attention, for my son goes to Haverford College, and one of the students, a year younger than he is, was shot. And they had a vigil in Haverford this last week for that student. During Blue Christmas services, often there are four candles that are lit for various different things in the different services. Why don't we instead lay a stone for each of those things that we think of usually during the Blue Christmas. A stone to acknowledge all those missing from our holiday celebrations or who are no longer with us. A stone for the bittersweet memory that may bring a tinge of sadness or regret when we think of those folks. But gratitude for the gifts that may have come from having them in our lives. A stone to honor ourselves, our resilience, our persistence to have hope and love for the world, and a time when we need to exercise self-care. Remember to take care of yourself during this holiday time. Lots of cocoa and hot buttered rum, whatever your hot comfort drink is that's good for you, this is the time. And a stone of hope for whatever gifts in life may come in this season, in the coming year, whether it's presents or presence of those we love at this time. A stone of joy, but also a stone of continuing care. Many of you were aware that our honey Jenny, who went back to Sweden to visit where she lives at times, Switzerland, and she, I think, fell at the airport and was in care in Switzerland. Thank goodness she's back home, and she's getting care here, so honey's back home. This is a time now, if you have things weighing on your hearts or celebrations that you'd like to mark with stones in the sand, please feel free to come forward and mark those in silence.
Downpour, appropriate today, a poem by Billy Collins. Last night, we ended up on the couch trying to remember all of the friends who had died so far. And this morning, I wrote them down in alphabetical order on the flip side of a shopping list you had left on the kitchen table. So many of them had been swept away as if by a hand from the sky. It was good to recall them, I was thinking, under the cold lights of a supermarket as I guided a cart with a wobbly wheel up and down the long, strident aisles. I was on the lookout for blueberries, English muffins, linguine, heavy cream, light bulbs, apples, Canadian bacon, and whatever else was on the list, which I managed to keep grocery side up. until I had passed through the electric doors, where I stopped to realize, as I turned the list over, that I had forgotten Terry O'Shea, as well as the bananas and the bread. It was pouring by then, spilling, as they say in Ireland, people splashing across the lot to their cars. And that is when I set out, walking slowly and precisely, a soaking wet man bearing bags of groceries, walking as if in a procession honoring the dead. I felt I owed this to Terry, who was such a strong painter, for almost forgetting him, and to all the others who had formed a circle around him on the screen in my head. I was walking more slowly now, in the presence of a compassion that the dead were extending to a comrade. Plus, I was in no hurry to return to the kitchen, where I would have to tell you all about Terry and the bananas and the bread.
Thank you, Kim. I don't know if any of you are on Facebook. Do we have Facebook? You don't have to admit it if you are. They say that that's partly will reveal our age if we're on Facebook these days. But sometimes it will come up with things that you weren't thinking of. You know, here's your picture from 8 years ago. Here's your picture from 4 years ago. And last week, I realized as a picture came up of my grandma and my dad that last week he would have turned 101. And memories of holidays past. He was so mad when the U.S. changed it. It used to be that it was, I think the last Thursday of every month was Thanksgiving. So that sometimes Thanksgiving would be on his birthday, something like that. And then they changed it, I don't know, or maybe it was the 30th, I can't remember. It used to be that sometimes Thanksgiving was on his birthday, and he was so mad that they changed it to always be on Thursday and something like that. So I was thinking of my dad, I was thinking how much Christmas was wrapped up with my father. I've probably shared it with you before, but for my family, we were big into Christmas. And I call it the Guthmann Family Christmas Marathon. And there are four kids, and it started on Thanksgiving. That's when Christmas officially started, because the department stores, I grew up in snow-covered Minnesota, the department stores, like the movie Christmas Story, would, in their windows on by Thanksgiving, have these elaborate windows, right? With moving parts, like it's a small world in Disneyland and all this stuff. And we would drive downtown after the big Thanksgiving dinner when the darkness fell so early and would go to see the windows, sometimes both in downtown St. Paul and downtown Minneapolis, depending on the weather. And thus it began. Then began the decorating and finding the tree and the singing and the cookie baking. And Mom is 94 and still, is that right? 95, and still makes fruitcakes that she mails to everybody like a brick. I can't imagine how expensive. Mike Siegler, I had shared that story with him because I know he likes fruitcake. And we, it just went on and on, handicrafts. We had Boy Scouts, Cub Scouts, Girl Scouts, Campfire Girls, and Mom was leading all of them, and there was a craft for every single one of them, every year a new craft.
Our house was full of them. We never threw them away. We just had more decorations every year. It was crazy, right? And I would listen to records for Christmas. That also tells you how old I am. Record after record. The Chipmunks sing the Beatles, but also the Chipmunks singing Christmas. And I had Julie Andrews and Robert Goulet and record after record. Well, there's many songs for Christmas, right? We've done some jazzy, beautiful ones this morning. And on one of the albums was Have Yourself a Merry Christmas. It was absolutely annoying. It would be, a merry little Christmas, a merry little Christmas, have yourself. And it was fast-paced. And even as a young kid, I thought it was annoying, and I would skip to the next one without trying not to damage the record, right? We also slowed down the Chipmunks so that we could hear the real voice, right, at 72. Okay, if you're older, you know what I mean. Anyway, so a merry little Christmas, and eventually I heard the original that Judy Garland made popular in Meet Me in St. Louis. It was sad. It was gorgeous. The little Margaret O'Brien was crying because they were moving from where they had always lived and were leaving everyone they knew. Would we have another happy Christmas again? It was gorgeous. I've always loved that song now. I never listened to that old version. I listened to these gorgeous, sad, melancholy, have yourself a merry, merry little Christmas. But growing up, I never associated sadness with Christmas. It was happy, happy, happy. And right during college, I would get these long breaks at holiday time, and I could get a job. I could work temporarily. And it was one of my first office jobs. And I was so excited. We were all excited about the holidays. We were going to decorate the office. We changed the music, the piped-in Muzak, to be Christmas Muzak. And we were going to have Secret Santas, and it was just going to be so much fun. And we started to play the music, and one of our older employees just was very sad. And she begged us. She begged us not to play the Christmas music. And we're like, what? You know, not play the Christmas music? And finally she shared with us that her husband had died during the holiday season, and ever since Christmas wouldn't be the same. It was disappointing, but we respected her. And I started to realize this holiday season can be mixed. As you grow older, there are certain markers in your life, yes? Maybe as you graduate from each school, grade school to high school and beyond, or you buy your first car, or maybe you're lucky to buy your first house, maybe you can make babies or adopt babies, retire. Certain markers, and I don't think we're fully prepared for any of them, no? This poem by Billy Collins that Kim read so beautifully speaks to a time in our lives when we can start listing all the people we knew who have died. He did it in alphabetical order. For me, I remember there was a certain time, I will call my mother every week, maybe one or two or more times. And there was a certain time I remember when I'd call her, she told me of another friend of hers, another longtime family friend who had died or had broken their hip and wasn't going to recover, dementia. And that list kept getting longer and longer. And these losses become more pronounced during holiday times, yes? Just when we're supposed to be so merry and happy. Reverend Josh Pollack wrote in a Blue Christmas sermon, "There's really only one message I want to bring to you this morning, and that is very simply, not everyone, every year, can enter fully into the joy, merriment, and hopefulness of the holiday season. It isn't always possible. For some, the bright lights, the season's greetings, the festive music, the Christmas trees, the messages of peace and goodwill, all of it can clash with our internal state, clashes with recent painful experiences, clashes with difficult childhood memories of the holidays. For some, there is dissonance. We're dreaming of a white Christmas, and yet for some, everything's gone blue. So the message is, it's okay. It's okay to feel sad and not feel guilty about it, to not stuff it away, but set yourself down by a fireplace, grab a blanket, and pour yourself an eggnog or a hot cocoa, whatever it is. I don't know if you're familiar with the custom of Yahrzeit, that Jewish custom that you would recognize and celebrate a person on the day, on the anniversary of their death. There are special Yahrzeit candles that you will light in their honor and let them burn until they burn down. Maybe this is a time of year when you go to the fireplace with your blanket, light a candle for that special person that you want to think of as being right there, their memory burning with you still. Toast to them and think of them. Maybe even talk to them by the fireplace. Let them know what's been going on in your life. Pick and choose at this time of year where you want to go, who you want to spend time with to help build you up and not bring you down, to not make you feel guilty. Be mindful of when you're loading too many expectations on yourself about gifts or baking or whatever is filling your heart with dread instead of joy at this time of year. In thinking about the melancholy that can take hold at this time of year as the days grow colder and shorter, I was thinking about a recent Committee on Ministry meeting that I attended. And the Reverend Elizabeth Harlem Shuba, that you all know, asked each of us to consider something at the beginning of our meeting. She's asked us, what is your love language? Now, some may be familiar. In the 90s, Gary Chapman, who was a minister and a marriage counselor, wrote many books about our five love languages. Sold millions of copies, right, of books. And I think you can still find those books, what, in Etsy and online and all like that. And he describes each of us as having a love tank. I love that. Think about you, each of us holding a love tank, that maybe our love tank doesn't feel so full sometimes, right? Just like a car. We fill up our tank, we can operate a little better in the world, our tank gets low, and we don't run so well. In this season, perhaps an antidote to blue Christmases is to consider how we give and receive love. What fills up our love tank, and how can we fill up the love tank of other people? And when we do, we're probably making the world feel just a little bit better too. So the five love languages that he talked about, maybe these all work for you. Maybe there's one or two primary ones that work for you that he talks about. And I want you to think about each of these as I go through them and imagine when you do them, when others do this for you, One of those love languages are acts of service, right? How does it feel when you get to do for others or when people do for you, right? Is your love language giving gifts, like bringing something special to a friend? You never go to a house without a little surprise for your friend. Is it physical touch? Are you a hugger? And without hugging, your love tank is just not very full. Is it quality time? Rather than a lot of gifts, would you rather just spend time with people? That the way you give is to call up and say, let's go for coffee and let's go for a walk. Give a call. My call with my mom once a week fills up my love tank. Is it words of affirmation? The cards you send to say thank you whenever someone does something kind for you, thank you. To let someone know you just look gorgeous. That was a beautiful song you sang. Those words of appreciation and affirmation. When I talk about these love languages, doing for others, giving to others, hugs, spending time with someone, what makes you feel good inside? Were there things that made you smile, that made you feel warm? Were there memories that came to your mind? What joyful memories, what stirred in your heart as you think about these ways that we give and receive love? Chapman would say that love is a choice. What path of love will you choose this holiday season? Perhaps speaking or doing your love language this holiday season will help soothe your soul, help you enter into the red and the green and the sparkles of the season, not just the blue melancholy and heaviness and long dark nights. In a sermon by UU minister, the Reverend Margaret Beckman, she notes, I am heartbroken. I am helpless. I'm furious, but I'm filled with compassion. I'm skeptical and cynical. I'm hopeful. I'm hopeless, just on different days. But love has no limits. There is one life, one light, and one everlasting and universal love that will never let us go. This is the spirit of our faith. It is the essence of you and all of our kin. She says, my dear spiritual companions, may you find your way into that love, and as you do, may you also find your way of showering the world with the same love. When all else seems lost or forgotten or hopeless, love whispers in your ear, I am here. Come find me. You may very well find your faith renewed. May it be so for you and for everyone everywhere. So let us sing together about chestnuts roasting on the open fire and some simple pleasures of the season. I don't know if the words are in your order of service, so I'm sorry, as much by heart as you can if they're not there. Are they there? Oh, good. Let us sing together the Christmas song.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire, Jack Frost nipping at your nose, Yuletide carols being sung by a choir, and folks dressed up like Eskimos. Everybody knows. turkey and some mistletoe. How to make the season bright. Tiny tots with their eyes all aglow will find it hard to sleep tonight. They know that Santa's on his way. He's loaded lots of toys and goodies in his sleigh. And every mother's child is gonna spy to see if reindeer really know how to fly. Hear it out. Santa's on his way. He's loaded lots of toys and goodies on his sleigh. And every mother's child is gonna spy to see if reindeer really know.
This is the time in our service when we will pass the plate and accept your offerings. You may also go to our website to make a donation online. A portion of the offering will be shared this month with Lancaster Food Hub. Serving the community since 1947, Lancaster's Food Hub's vision is to serve anyone in need of food, clothing, shelter, believes in the dignity of all individuals, and is motivated by faith to welcome all to assist and all in need. While the plates are passed, I will be making some announcements, and the plates may now be passed. Do look to our weekly email newsletter, the Love Letter, for weekly need-to-knows and events at UUCL, as well as our Facebook page and website calendar. To sign up for the newsletter, look to our website or contact our office. UUCL and the UU Congregation of York are having a virtual collection for the Central Pennsylvania Food Bank, and for instruction. The first Sunday of every month, Founders Hall downstairs is prepared for a labyrinth walk, and that would be today. Feel free to walk in the labyrinth following the service. Join UUCL members and friends at the menorah lighting at Penn Square in Lancaster at 5:30 p.m. on Friday night. Rabbi Jack Paskoff of Congregation Sharai Shomalim will lead the brief service. And then some UUCL folks hope to spend some time together at a nearby eatery. Okay, it says 5:30, 4:30, I'm corrected. Saturday, December 9th, we will be having a holiday gathering hosted by the Spirituality of Making group with a Walters Unitarian Trust grant. And again, look to the Love Notes for volunteer opportunities. Many of our holiday activities are listed on the back of your order of service today in nice color. Every Sunday, we like to gather together and enjoy tea, coffee, and conversation. And if you would like to help make that happen and also clean up, please touch base with Darcy, our board member today here in the back. She was in the back, and Carol Campbell, who is toward the front. Next week's Sunday service will be meditation on light and darkness led by Elizabeth Galron, our faith development person, and Eli Sauls. And the children's program will focus on Hanukkah. The plates have been passed, and we gratefully receive your generous gifts freely given this morning and dedicate them to the work and aspirations of this congregation. And now let us join together to read in unison the affirmation of faith, which you will find in the front, the back of the front cover of, opposite the, just inside the front cover of your gray hymnal. First in English we read it, and then in Spanish. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its gift. This is our great covenant. To dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. El amor es el espíritu de esta iglesia, y el servicio es su ofrenda. Este es nuestro gran pacto, el convivir unidos en paz, el buscar la verdad en amor, y ayudarnos unos a los otros.
In the coming days and weeks, despite the elaborate decorations, lights, and trees, amidst the time of busyness, make a place for yourself. Find some time to reflect upon the unadorned parts of your life. May you enjoy and share the simple pleasures of the season, eat, laugh, sing, be with those you love dearly. In this season, may your heart be renewed. Bless you.
Thank you.